And to be honest, I'm probably not going to use my line stick on this part because I got these flutes to guide me. I have my flutes to guide me. So I'm just going to go about one third, right? So I'm going to do about one third of the barrel of my column in shape. Not even going to skim. A good, strong shape. Carve this puppy. Doesn't that piss you off? But Susan says she's not going to use a line stick on there.
We all knew it was going to be perfect.
Huh?
We all knew it was going to be perfect. There's
no problem. So, cutting lines gets easier and easier the more you. So this one, I'm doing a little bit of wiggle. Just so that I can blend them out. All right, cool. Then on this side of the column, I am going to use my line stick. I'm going to get just a little bit of creaky shade on this side of my column. Let's see, I think I can move the camera around so that there is a better view. Sorry for those of you who are watching this right now on YouTube. There we go. All right. Just to say, I am doing the go-round thing. I'm going around. So with all of these forms on this, the base and coming up into the capital, you don't just have to worry about shaping it in this direction, right? We also have to worry about shaping these forms in this direction, right? What we're going to do is we're going to separate those two concepts out. So the first thing we're going to do is we're just going to worry about the cylindrical shape that all these forms inhabit. Then we're going to come back and we're going to sculpt the shape of the form itself in the horizontal, okay? We're not going to try and do those two things at the same time, okay? So when I'm doing this, like this bad boy flares up like this, and we come up there, and then he flares around like that, curves around like that, I should say. So we're just going to follow that profile. Now I want you to think about these profiles when you do that. because if we're going right up the center, we don't observe any profile at all, right? Because we're looking at all of those profiles. But as you move out to the edge, those profiles, as they wrap around those forms, get deeper and deeper and deeper, okay? So when I come around this curve, it's like, it's kind of shallow, okay? It's not super, super extreme. It's not as extreme as it is at the outside of this column in the section view, okay? Make sense? So, and then we're gonna soften them a little bit. Cool. And now I'm just gonna come along and do the same thing at the base of the column. So I'm just going to pull my shade down through my profile. Paint on my brush. Once again, just not as dramatically as it is in the section view. Always trying to look for that. Am I getting approximately? I don't believe I am. That's better. Approximately 1/3 of my form. I can start dealing with the horizontal parts of the form. Okay? Actually, let me get that a little bit. smaller brush, and I'm going to catch some of this detail on the sides now. Nope, that's why I was getting a smaller brush. I was just getting a smaller brush so I would have more control. And now I will start dealing with the horizontal. That shade is deepening as it goes around the base of the column, or the curve, the curve of the column. So whenever that shade is dropping, don't try to make it do the cast shadow job. We'll get into that next week. But you can definitely have it curve around, okay? So that it's not an abrupt and distracting flaring. These little doobers. Just the tiniest little shade, and then I'm going to try and blend it. most of your columns, this guy just below these little double curved louvers, is a fascia, but in this case, on this profile, it's a little quarter round facing down, so I put a shade on it. And that is it. So now I'm just going to blend. We're kind of waiting for all of this to set up. We're just going to come and deal with the top of the capital, the tap. So what's happening with this tap is when we look at it in section view, right? Or top view, excuse me, not section view. The cap is doing this, right? So if we have the light on this cap coming from this direction, this part of that surface is going to end up being in shade, okay? So that's the first thing we're gonna do, just like we did with the barrel. That we're going to have the shade because it's curving in, coming in from the other direction. So we're just going to have a little bit of a shade. Coming in on this entire profile. From that direction. It's going to be deeper down here. Not quite as deep here at the top. Okay, so what it's going to follow, once again, the contour to a certain. Okay, but we're going to soften it out pretty well because it's a pretty gentle curve, all right? Then we can come through and do our contour. So this is a quarter cove. It's pretty deep. We have a fascia, so nothing happens to him. And here, we have a downward facing quarter round. He's going to be pretty deep as well. I have no idea, gender-wise, why I decided that it was a he. No reason at all. I know he's mushing into my rosette a little bit. I'll do a little bit of eraser brush. Honestly, not terribly worried about that rosette. He's got a lot of like fussy work that needs to happen on him that will probably circumvent or cover up everything that I just said. All right, do a little bit of softening. I don't know if I want to soften this guy up at the top or not. Bit. Just gonna be the tiniest little bit of base that's peeking up at the top of that quarter round. And then I grab my detail brush. So on this guy, I'm just going to follow that profile. Sculpt the profile, excuse me. So I'm just going to sculpt that profile there, sculpt this profile here. Okay, then this guy, facing into the shade side, I'm simply going to go ahead and put him entirely in the shade, fascia and all. So, is anything not making sense to anybody at this point? Okay. Now that my paint has had time to set up a little bit, I'm going to go ahead and hit my glues. The first thing that I want to think about is, here's my lip side of the column barrel, right? So within this lip side, we know the highlight comes about one third of the way in, okay? So what we want to do is we want to find that flute or that fillet that essentially is sort of our sweet spot for our highlight, okay? You just sort of want to sight that in your mind, all right? So I've got my sweet spot, which is like right about here. This is going to be my sweet spot for my highlight. So now I'm going to sculpt my flutes on either side of that. This flute that's right pretty much almost center in my sweet spot, my highlight sweet spot, is not going to get any shade whatsoever. Okay? And you guys notice how he was naughty with these, and we actually did flutes that were a little bit fatter on the PC model. Sorry. So this guy, I emulate that with a little bit of water, partly because he's such a fat flute. So he does need to be blended out a little bit. On your flutes, you may not have to lay down any water, okay? You might just need to like paint your shade and then do a little bit of just a like runnel bead of water along to it to let it melt, okay? So I'm not gonna follow down into this flute too much with my shade. Remember, this is carving up, right? So at the bottom of that flute, if we drew a big flute here on the floor, right? The bottom of a big flute here on the floor. What's going to happen with that shade? We've got a shade coming down here. Is that shade is going to end kind of like that at the bottom of that flute, because the light, it's gonna follow the contour at the bottom of this flute, all right? So it's gonna curve around towards the highlight side, okay? So I'm gonna be careful not to like dig down and like try to follow the bottom of that, the contour of the bottom of that flute, because I want it to like curve around like that. Okay? cool thing about trompe l'oeil is it really has just like kind of common sense geometry and purpose when you get down to it. Right, soften him a little bit. All right, next please. Really, really close to my highlight. All right, so I'm just gonna put a little suggestion of a shade in there. And then this guy, same thing, got this one that's once again very, very close to the highlight. Switching sides now because the light's coming from the other direction. Just laying in enough shade to do my sculpting. Let it stay pretty subtle. And then moving to this last fluke. This is farther away from my highlight. And then the tops of my boots have definitely had some shade. Every single one of them, even the one in the highlight area. And we have sculpted the barrel of our column. Yep. Okay. Now, the capital. Yay, the capital. Are you okay?
Oh, yeah.
Yes. This guy?
Yeah.
Because they're facing down. They're facing down. But we're totally going to catch a good, strong highlight on this. And then this is the place where reflective lights will be your friend. Love me some reflective lights going. I feel like you need to have more of a sense of light to you, and you need to be separate from this here, and that's when we'll get into reflective light next week. Okay? So right now, go ahead and sculpt it, and go, I don't know. That's where we're going to talk reflective light next week. Okay? I'm like, I need to give you more emphasis. I need to, like, talk about how you're more facing more towards the light. But you are in the shade. There's no doubt about it. But I can't put reflective lights in you and get a good separation from this plane from that plane. Okay? All right. So moving into the column. Now, the thing that's cool about a Corinthian column, if you know what's hiding inside a Corinthian column? Marble. What's hiding inside a Corinthian column is a very classic Egyptian column capital. All right? So what's hiding inside there is this super classic Egyptian column capital form. All right? That's what you're looking at here and here. It's that classic Egyptian column capital. All right? So, we're going to treat this part and this part as if it's just a column capital that's that shape. Okay? So we're gonna go, okay, where is that like sort of one-third sweet spot? I'm saying you're mostly in shade there because you've got that flare at the top. I'm just going to blend that. And then I'm like, okay, so if this is that flare, here at the top, where we would like lay a shade in here, right? And then we would put our shade on that column capital, doing something approximately like this. That's what we're painting inside behind those roots, okay? So this is a fascia that's just curving around. So we have our nice, like, flat. We know that this is pretty much all in shade. And then here we have a flare. So basically a little portico. And we're going to put that low light in there. Okay? So that's how you resolve these interior spaces. Okay? Does that make sense? It was quite a revelation for me when I finally figured that out. I was like, oh. And it's just also a metaphor, right? For the whole, like, Roman Empire, starting with that little nugget of, like, the Egyptian, kingdom and empire, right? Katie, stop laughing at me.
Laughing with
you. Okay. Now, let's go to our volutes. Okay? So we have these volutes, and you just have to decide which way these volutes are pointing, okay? So we have kind of running out of blackboard here. I'm trying to see where, like, the camera can still see. All right, so we've got volutes that are doing, we've got one volute that's going this way, all right? And then we have another set of volutes in the center that are doing this, right? And then we have another volute that's going that way, okay? So if our light's coming from here, we're like, okay, this volute can be pretty shadowy, right, pretty much in the shade. This balloon here is catching a lot of light. This is actually a cylinder thing because it's going around the front edge of those two balloons, so we're going to treat that like a cylinder. This balloon here is in the shade, and this balloon here is catching light. Make sense? Okay? So we're just going to go ahead now and deal structurally with our balloon. We're going to go, all right, Goober, you are in the shade. Putting you in the shade, but boyo. Huh? I did. Putting you in the shade. And he's definitely, like, he is really facing away from the light, right? He's like, like, I could be catching some light. I'm not catching a lot of light. This is just sort of an automatic thing. I'm not saying it's right or wrong if you don't do this, but like I thinned out my shade just a little bit, so it's not quite as dramatic. Right? And then what's happening underneath here? Well, if you think about these volutes as curling under, and you think about this bottom edge, you're like, well, this is the bottom edge or the bottom facet of this balloon. So I'm totally putting him, that bottom facet of this balloon, in shade. Same over here. A little bit. Okay. Now, if I think about the front edges of these balloons here, right, it's basically like we said, a cylinder. So I'm going to take that front edge. You should, this doesn't, but you should have a line right here that goes from the bottom of this balloon to the bottom of that balloon, the bottom of that cylinder, that roll. Okay? And then this guy here, this outside edge of this balloon, is facing in the same direction as this part of the cap. Right? So we're going, okay, you're facing away from the light. I'm going to go ahead and put you in shade. Right? Since it's a down light, I might let up on it a little bit towards the top, where the top of that cylinder is coming into the light a little bit. Okay? But he's mostly going to be in shade. Then this side of the balloon, it's a cylinder, so I'm going to do that shade on the bottom of my cylinder. Okay? So that takes care of these structural bits. Okay? Now, moving on to our acanthus leaves. Just remember that you're still back to a cylinder. So taking these curling out leaves aside, like dismissing these guys essentially to begin with, where on this cylinder do you have shade? Okay? That's all. all you have to do. So we're going to go ahead and we're going to decide where our shade is. It's like following this up, flare, flare, in, and our shade starts right about here. You're like, okay, this acanthus leaf, he's all the way in shade. We'll deal with the caps in a minute. This acanthus leaf totally facing into the shade side of life here. We're going to do him. This acanthus leaf. All right. Have these reeds. The reed bundles are basically like little half round bundles. Okay, I don't think I had a reed bundle. Any of these. But they're like the reed bundles are just basically half round bundles of half round. Basically, I showed so many of you when we were cartooning. It's as if you had a perfectly round rod. And then you add six rods that were clustered around it. You glued all that together and cut it in half down the center. That's what the reed bundle looks like, right on the front. So we're going to go ahead and put a shade here on our side of the reed bundle and a shade here on the side of this reed bundle. All of this stuff that's attached to the top of your reed bundle follows that cylindrical shape. So we're going to go ahead and lay our shade in on all of this stuff, okay? So it's like now, essentially, we have dealt with the cylindrical shape of our column cap, of our column capital, and our acanthus leaf. Do a little cleaning up here. So now I need to start shaping individually within this context my acanthus leaves. So I just want you to like look at these acanthus leaves outlaying on the edge. See how they're curling over? You're like, if this is curling over, where is the light going to start hitting this acanthus leaf? And you're like, it's going to be in the shade till right about down here. And you're like, even though this acanthus leaf looks shallower because it's foreshortened, it still means that that is about how deep my shade needs to go on the inside of my acanthus leaf. So I can come through knowing that. I'm looking at these acanthus leaves down here and this one up here, and I'm like, the shade's going to go down to about here on the inside of this acanthus leaf, which means that it's going to go to about there on the inside of this acanthus leaf. And even though this acanthus leaf is facing front, that shade's going to go down on that acanthus leaf. And this is actually going to go a little bit deeper because this acanthus leaf is standing alone. And then do a little bit of blending. And then same with these guys. I'm like, where does the shade go down to on these lower acanthus leaves? It's going to go down to about here. So that means that shade is going to go down on those acanthus leaves to about there, regardless, because it's curling down. The form is curling down. Think of it like a piece of ribbon curling around, okay, before you think about all of the individual little details on the edge of the acanthus leaf, okay? All right. Now, on this one especially, this version, we do have a lot of holes. I'm just going to fill those holes in with shade. So assuming that we're going back to possibly the Egyptian column underneath, but basically, like, go away. Oh, didn't do this again this week, but that one. This one. This guy's facing in the same direction as this outside of the blue. So I'm going to put the cat in significant shape. Okay? So by doing that, I've broken this down into structure. And that's what you want to do, is you want to see the structure in the form. So that you're not just like there trying to like sculpt leaves. You're sculpting the structure of the leaves first. Okay? All right, good. Now I'm going to switch to my detail brush and just start doing a little bit of finessing. So I need to decide what's happening with my volutes. Now, my volutes, you go dark on me. You. My volutes can have a couple of different things happening. So we're talking about the edges of my volutes from here to here. Okay? I see, I actually have a little bit of a lace here. I got the lace. That's how it is. That's the back to put a highlight there. So my volutes might be doing this, or if you just have, if you don't have this line that continues on the bottom, my volutes might be doing this. All right, so you just have to decide what shape is happening in here, okay? And then you just have to decide as you are taking it, with the light coming down and from here, right?
The bottom line? Which one?
These lines. Inside here.
Okay.
So then you just have to decide, let me get my line stick out of the way. Move this up a little bit. Just have to decide. Now this guy is sort of facing directly into your light, right? Because he's just like your light's kind of coming from that direction. So I'm mostly going to shade these volutes at the top on this, on, or the insides of these volutes from the top. This guy here, the light's definitely coming at a different angle to him, but not that much. So once again, I'm going to pay attention to the top. And then I just go through, and with these caps and the leaves on the side, I decide where I have detail. So I'm like, okay, these leaves are sculpting around this way, right? So, oh, one other thing. This one, see how the leaves go straight down? A lot of you have a little bit of an OG curve at the bottom. In which case, you'll end up needing to have a shade here as well, okay? To catch the bottom of that OG curve, okay? And on this particular form, it's actually not a shade. then I just come along and I stop my leaf. And this is actually a little bit of a ragged. These are kind of ragged looking sentences here. I will admit. So do you have any questions about how to handle the structure of your cactus leaf when you go working into the shade? Does it make sense that you're understanding what the structure of the leaf is and looking at it as a sculptural geometric object rather than like, ah, it's a leaf? And you can all see why I like worked with a lot of you to simplify your leaf, right? So that you didn't have to think about so much. Okay. So let's head into the low light. So I'm setting my line stick up for this low light on the flute, or on the fillet, on that edge, so that my fillet is not in, gonna catch the low light, that fillet right on the edge there is not going to catch that low light. I'm going to leave a little bit of shade showing on that side. So a little bit of green light. Lay a little bit of water down. Remember, about one-third of my shade area is going to be low light, right? No, the low light is, they're both pretty neutral. The low light is definitely cooler and darker. All right. And following one third, so really about the width of the let's bring it here. Your low light on much more than one third of the shade area. I'm not going to carry low light all the way across all the flutes on my palm. Right? Like I'm not. This is my sweet spot right here for my highlight. Like I've got pretty good delineation between that blue and the base coat next to it. Which I feel I want to do that. And basically you just have to read it. You have to like read it and figure out what it is it wants. What is it that it needs? So I'll tell you what I am gonna do. Is my low light got a little crazy over here in this blue on the low light side of the column. So I'm just going to go ahead and go back into that blue and pull a more concentrated low light into it, and then I'll decide. Squint your eyes at it. Read it. Decide what it needs. I'm saying no. I'm saying he's doing his job. That I'm going to flatten it out more than I'm going to help it if I put a low light into that blue there. Okay? So I vote no.
Will your flutes get any reflective light?
Hell yeah.
So that would help.
Absolutely. Yep. Like the blank is the best, you guys. Alright, so now I'm going to do, but anyway, like, that shade in low light. Like, squint your eyes now and go, are you doing it? Are you doing it to your job? Is there a place on the column where it's flattening out? Okay? So read your column. I'm going to go ahead and do my horizontal. Little bit of delineation here. I can cheat a little bit with my low light. But remember, I've got my reflected lights just around the corner in this process, so they can help me. There are low lights that will go all over the Capitol. If you look at that one, and then when this is done, you'll see, like I'll be doing, like for instance, low light down here, right? Totally has a little bit of a low light down here. This one is a low light on the Egyptian Capitol that's hiding inside. Doing low lights. This is in the shade, but I still haven't done low lights yet. The light's coming up there. Mostly I'm going to do the balloons probably from the top again. They're at that angle. So I'll be doing low lights inside the balloon. Totally laying low light in the temperature. So same thing, it's like now I've done the shade on the acanthus leaves. I want to figure out where the low light goes on the acanthus leaves. So I'm like, all right, I think it's getting low light down to about here. So I'm going to go all the way across these acanthus leaves, and I'm going to be laying low light up inside those acanthus leaves, with bottom of the leaf where it curls over. All the way across. And then, going to be figuring out that if this is 1/3, I'm totally going to be figuring out which acanthus leaves, which part of this circular form the back side of these leaves, right, or the upright part of these leaves is sort of hugging that form. So I figure out which acanthus leaves are hugging that form and basically like the barrel of the column, 1/3 of this form is definitely going to have lowlight on it, right? And the undersides of these blues, these like they're definitely in the low light. I've got a little bit of low light just on the outside edge of these leaves. And then, totally no light right there. I just want to make this hole a little bit deeper. So I never did deal with the rosette. Ignore the rosette. A little bit of shade. Outside of this rosette. And then on the leaves themselves, after you've done that, after you've gotten your lowlights into the structure of those acanthus leaves, then you just decide in the form of those acanthus leaves where you're going to do a little bit of definition with your shades and your lowlights. But you want to deal with the structure of the acanthus leaves first with your lowlights. Same as you did with the shades. So then it's like, okay, do I have a low light? Is there a low light that's kind of creeping along the edge of this stick, right? Do I have a low light creeping along there? Do I have low light? If you know these caps, curl under, do I have a little bit of low light digging to the bottom of these caps? I'm going to catch it through. Do I have a little bit of low light kind of following the edge of these lacy leaves? Right? So you decide where it is that you want to augment the leaves with a little bit of lowlight. Okay? He curls under. He definitely gets lowlight up. Right? It's done really fast, but when you squint your eyes at it, you can see the structure of the column capital, right? That's what you're going for, first and foremost, with your shades and your low light. Okay, it's going for that structure. You can come back and do the frilly little niceties later, right? Especially when you get into the highlight stage. So get the structure of that column capital in there with your shades and your low light. Okay?
All right. And we are totally out of time. Nope. You have shades, low lights, and primary highlights.
And you guys can do it. Remember, you've got an example over there, and I've already shown you where the shades and low lights go, which means you should be able to determine where your primary highlights go. Plus, I'll finish both of these up to that point, so you'll have this as an example. So, say that you did with the bottom of the column, we're going to go to the top now.
If I can find my brushes.
Anything else, a little tiny fascia there, it doesn't get anything. Not until we get to cast shadows. So we're going to jump up now to the quarter round. So just whenever you're doing the shade on forms like this, whenever you're setting up any of your trompe points, just keep thinking of going in one direction at a time. Don't try to do both directions at a time, because that's when you're going to get like confused and flummoxed. It's like, what do I need to make this verticality happen? Now what do I need to make the horizontal happen? And it'll be so much straightforward. So in that vein, let's move on now directly to the capital. So remember, we've got a different shape. Our balloons are not going around. They're protruding out from the cylinder. And essentially, if this is the cylinder here, right, of our column, and our capital top is doing this, right? Hello, camera. You want to see this too? There you go. Then our volutes
are doing this and then coming out underneath these guys. Okay? All right? So in doing that, like if we have our light source coming in from this direction, the same as we decided we would have some soft shade there, we're going to put some soft shade on this side of the volute. It's mostly facing away from the light. Definitely on this side of this volute, it's facing away from the light. Okay? Sort of cylindrical curve right there. We're going to go ahead and put him in shadow. The underneath section of the volute. If you think about that volute curling out, right? And this actually being a hollow cavity here. The underneath side of the volute. We're going to go ahead and put him in shadow. I've decided that my rosette, that center button rises, and then the petals do something like that, right? So I'm going to have a shape, and then a shape on the petals outside, on the inside, and a shape on the petals. So for the
once again, remember that you are dealing with the cylinders. So what I want you to think about is I want you to think about the stalks, the bottom part of these acanthus leaves, without thinking about the caps that are folding up and over, okay? So those caps that are folding up and over, discount those for now. Does that make sense? So what you're going to do is the same as you did your barrel of the column. You're going to do about one third of this section where the stalks of your acanthus leaves are in shade. Kind of painting around the caps for now, okay? So basically, you're going to form the shape of the face first and not worry about the eyelashes, right? Now, we're going to come to something that's more akin, I would say, to the cheekbones. So if we look at these acanthus leaves and we look at them in section, the stalks are coming up and over, right? Up and over. This underside of the acanthus leaf is going to be in shade on this top row until down about here. What we're going to do is we're going to carry that shade all the way across our acanthus leaf, using that as our guidepost for how far down the shade should go. So next one, if this particular acanthus leaf is in shade until down around there, then that means that this one and this one are as well. And this acanthus leaf is sort of a standalone that we can judge by how far out this acanthus leaf here is folding over. Then we probably want our shape to go down to about here. All of a sudden, like we're starting to see the pattern of it, right? And it makes sense. It's like really straightforward. Are there any questions at this point? Doing good? Okay. So we have our stalks of reeds here, and you all understand that essentially what we're seeing in those stalks of reeds, at least as this one is drawn,
is we're seeing that profile, right?
That's our inception view.
So we're just going to go ahead and go, and that means that you did a shade there, and you did a shade there. And that all this proofread that's connected to those stocks is going around basically a cylindrical shape. Now I'm just filling in again some of these nooks and crannies. Putting that acanthus leaf there, mostly in shade. Okay. So this takes care of a lot of our structure in our Corinthian capital. We've got a couple of nooks and crannies right here, which are the bottom of that loop that's curling towards us. There we go. Okay. The next thing I'm going to think about is, I'm going to think about what's happening with these balloons. So I want you to think, keep recording. I want you to think that your balloons can be formed in a couple of different ways. I've seen a couple of different structures. So right now, on this balloon, I've got a double line here and a double line there. Okay? If I got the two double lines, then what I probably have is a structure that looks something like this on the inside between these two rims, okay? Sometimes you're just going to see one double line on one side, and what that usually is that's usually a structure like this, or occasionally a structure that sort of has an OG curve in it, okay? So you need to look at your balloon and decide what the structure is of the side of your balloon. Now, because this is facing it at an angle, and this is facing at a somewhat more shallow angle, they're both facing more into the light. So they're both getting mostly down light. Alright? So that's how we're going to take the boat. Come back with my low light, and I'm going to do the same thing with my low light to get more definition to the sides of the balloons that are in the shade. Okay? Now I can come back and do some of the niceties with my smaller detail brush on my acanthus leaf. I see how this guy curls around. Coming out. stuff out of the column bits. A lot of you have a canvas sleeve that are OG curving down into your down into the base of the column down or the top of the barrel, right? So you might end up having a shade that goes right along here at the bottom of your canvas sleeve to reflect that. To reflect the bottom of that OG curve. Does that make sense? Yep? So I'm going to just finish doing a little bit of definition here. And then I am going to be ready to do some low light. Y'all doing okay? You're not falling asleep on me, are you? Light on the side thing, because I know I'm going to be hitting this bad boy with reflective light later. So I can just use the light from ever. About a third of the area of my shade can be low light. I want to show you something and you can do it with a lot of things. Remember I told you that occasionally I would have to paint columns with enthesis in them? Right? That gentle curve. Like, how the freak do you do that, right? Thank you. So that's how you do a very gentle, and you can do it more if you really need to. You can work it out so that you angle your brush more. But that's how we followed an end piece of slide, okay? It's a big pain in the popo, especially if that designer gives you a column that has entesis in it and it's fluted. Right? You like that, and you like. Then I have to charge you. So I'm definitely not going to put a low light on this. That shade is plenty. So I'm going to put a low light on this flute right here. Gavin has been through all of this plenty of toys. Is this helping, Gavin?
Yeah.
Uh-oh.
It's helping me. I just gotta like fade out the low light. Because the low light is just too strong on that. So seeing you redo the low light, I'm like, yeah, that's how it should have gone.
Taking care of the top of the barrel here where it flares. Remember, the low light kind of curves around with the shade. Down and deal with my low lights on the base. First of all, let's bring those low light, that low light down around the base.
to remember. It depends on the venue that you're working in. There are some venues where there's no point in blending anything out. Most of the restaurant lawyers usually done at the Metropolitan Opera, there's no blending out. It's not necessary. Optically mixes from a distance. The Muni, I want you to also think about the size of the form that you're working on, because some forms, like these little lips here, absolutely no point, and you take some time to blend them. I had the misfortune a couple of days ago with some sort of documentary, whatever, article on the news or something. I can't even remember what it was. But it was a celebration of the village people, like an anniversary of YMCA. I could not get that damn song out of my head. Like, I'm usually pretty good at dislodging mind worms, but that day is, like, it's really stuck. Okay, and then coming back to these bad boys now. I've done the structure, I did the inner structure, the Egyptian column capital inside. I do a little bit of work on the cylinder. Hard. So then I decide which part of which acanthus leaf. Like I say, this stalk of this acanthus leaf, definitely in low light territory. Gonna come all the way up. He's definitely in low light territory. And I'm just gonna come up and do low light into the underside of the leaf. My low light, essentially, of the cylindrical form there. I'm going to do a little low light action on the insides of my loops. I'm only doing the low light that are in the shade. But because it's not that serious a contour, I'm not doing low lights in the ones that are facing towards the light. I am not saying that there is a perfect and formulaic way to paint a Corinthian column. When you hear me say things like that, please don't think that you have to memorize every move I make. You have to discern how it's working for you. But you may make different decisions than I just made, okay? Just as long as you're consistent and you understand why you make the decisions that you make, okay? So now I'm going to attach the underneath side of my canvas leaves. So I'm like, yeah, there's definitely a little bit of low light action happening underneath these bad boys. All the way across. structure. Like, you squint your eyes and you're like, yeah, the structure of the Corinthian column is there, right? And it makes sense. Okay? So, we have 45 minutes left. What do you want to do? Do you want to start mixing your color palette? Do you want me, what is due next week is your shade, your low light, and your primary highlight. Do you think you can go forward with your primary highlight? Or do you need some demo on your primary highlight? No? Huh? You would think that highlights would want to hug the edges of the flutes. But think of it, it's just the opposite of your cylinder. Does the highlight hug the edges of the cylinder? The cylinder looks more round if you don't have the highlight hug the edge. It's the same with the inside of the flute. Now sometimes, yes, you're going to pop the edge of the flute. But when that flute is facing in to the highlight, you're not going to pop the edge. Because if you do, that's actually going to be the opposite of what you want it to be. Okay? You see how you ground it up here? Depending on where our highlights are, what it's going to do is where they end, it's going to end in approximately a rounded shape. So closest to the sweet spot, that's where our highlights will be the tallest. And then as they get out towards the edges, they're going to drop. Okay? So, I'm looking at this guy, you're like, well, that's like creepy shade over there, so surely there's no highlight there. Except there is. And since this is very close to being perpendicular to this perpendicular to this place, we are going to have the edge. They're either describing the contour and helping to sculpt the contour of a shape, or they're describing an edge. Most of the highlight work that we do with describing an edge will be done with your secondary highlight. So, as I'm describing the shape, I know I'm going to get the edge of this fillet with my secondary highlight. So, I'm not going to worry about that right now. I am going to describe the shape.
I am reading this column right now. So now I'm going to go ahead and do my highlight. And what I'm going to do is that one third distance in the air, I'm just going to follow that sweet highlight on down through the form. Okay? I need a better behaved brush for these guys.
the fork and not so much. If I went sideways, I would probably end up telling the wrong story. I would tell the story of the mortality of that surface, even though it's going around. Okay? So if you notice through the lutes, if we pull back during an axis of the direction of light through the lute, that helps reinforce the form. So I like this here, an axis through the lute. It helps reinforce the form. Thank you. warmth that's going to feel. Thank you. same as when you dealt with your shades and your lowlights. Figure out where your highlights go on the inside, right? And then decide which caps are coming out and catching light. Okay? Questions? How much different? It's quite, you mean form wise, you have to read it. Right, you do. It's flat across. And don't forget that in terms of trying to figure that out, you've got a good model right here. Also, you have an ionic, although they covered it up with cardboard, but we'll uncover it. There's an ionic capital over there. Any other questions? Oh, shoot, it turned off. I wonder when it turned off. Nope, still going.